And joining us now is Junkies political editor Osman Faruqi. Osman, did you expect them to get away with this so lightly?
Hey, who would have thought that, you know, a bunch of rich white guys from Sydney's northern beaches could do this sort of stuff without impunity?
Not me.
Yeah, I don't know. It's interesting. We didn't really know what the charges were going to be until today. And I think as soon as we realised that it was public nuisance and that didn't have a jail term, it just had a fine, you kind of knew that things had been worked out, and either the Malaysian government or the courts or whatever had decided that they'd made enough of an example of these guys just by dragging them, you know, through the public eye and locking them up for 4 days. Mm. So I guess I wasn't too surprised that they ended up getting booted out of the country without a conviction.
Look, they must have been breathing a sigh of relief today. And 4 days in jail, in a Malaysian jail, can't be fun.
Yeah.
Do we feel any sympathy for them?
Tell us how to feel.
How should we feel about this?
I've kind of had a roller coaster of emotions. Like, I wasn't really feeling for them at all until today. And again, like I said earlier, they're literally the least sympathetic guys in the country, right? Mm. They went to private schools. Their parents are quite well connected. They went to colleges at Sydney University. They work for the Liberal Party. Like, how could these guys become the heroes that Australia, you know, emblazoned the front page of the newspaper and that sort of thing? But, you know, I think, like, they're not the first time. They're not the first case of Australians getting arrested in Malaysia. Mm. It's a case of an activist, Nat Lowry, a few years ago, who was actually doing something cool. She was protesting a mine that was, you know, messing with the local environment. She didn't get a front page story in the Daily Telegraph. Mm. So I think there kind of is this other thing going on where, when this stuff happens, elements of the media will come out and back good old fashioned Aussie boys.
I think it has more to do with the fact that they were almost naked.
You reckon?
I'm down with class warfare as much as the next man, but that story didn't involve a bunch of semi-naked dudes.
But there was
semi-naked dude sells papers. I think that's written in a journalism.
Do you reckon, I mean, there were some sloppy rigs, though. It wasn't like they were the most chiseled kind of guys.
Ain't nobody on this desk is in a position to judge.
I'm not the one getting down to my budgie smugglers.
Now, do you think the result would have been different if they weren't kind of rich, privileged, white dudes, though?
I think the thing that would have been the most different would have been the media attention that they got. And I think maybe it's got to do with the fact that, I think, look, Mark, you're right. There were budgie smugglers, there were half-naked guys that added to the whole circus aspect to it. But I think the fact that they come from the Australian, I guess, political and business elite meant that we were going to talk about them no matter what. Whether or not that influenced how the Malaysian court system dealt with it, I'm not really sure. But I think there is a big difference in the fact that they came from that background. That's why we talked about them all week, basically.
It's safe to say that the internet has had a lot of fun with this. Of all of the different reactions that have come out of this, what's your favourite?
My favourite thing, it only happened today in the courts, right, where their lawyer argued that, look, they're surf lifesavers, they're used to just taking off their clothes, you know, whenever they... And so everyone on Twitter immediately roasted the lawyer, and he's like, surf lifesavers, I mean, these guys weren't surf lifesaving in Malaysia.
Yeah, they were just surfing. The sharks at the Formula One?
He was sort of saying, you know, their instinct kicked in and they just took their clothes off and they're wearing Speedos. That's obviously not what went down.
My favourite thing that's come out of that is that because of that, Exhibit 1 to 9 in the court today was 9 budgie smugglers laid out in the court.
Tended as evidence. Oh, Australian-made budgie smugglers.
Yeah, and they wouldn't have been able to wash them either, because was there DNA evidence that needed to be
included?
Yeah, you're
right, they couldn't have tampered with
it. Let's crack this case wide open.
This is the real story. The poor court.
Okay, thanks, Oz, for joining us.
Thanks, guys.